nana kala dara pulungra ka ngara nyole runa pokor pra wanang wanang marjina kalkengro obar kongro. Just I just said that in my Yolngu language, Kumach language, that I welcome you all from wherever you have come from, near and far, if not overseas, I welcome you. Where I stand today is Gulkula. The land of my ancestors. This is the headquarters of Ganbulabula, a lawmaker for my people. Ganbulabula has many names. Yangbunenji, Yangbulul are two of them, but he has many. He lives in us, as he is our lawmaker and lawgiver. This is his home, and it is a home of the Garjambal, the great red kangaroo. Garjambal is a guardian for all Australians. He is on the Australian coat of arms. In many ways, he is the original Australian. So we honor him as an ancestor and a part of our ancient history, because Garjambal gave himself in the times of creation. He gave a sacred item to Ganbulapula as the law was created. And this item bound the two together. It bound the ancient past with the future. That item is Ganing, a sacred ironwood staff given to Ganbulapula by Garjambal. Garjambal is the ancient, and Ganbulapula the modern. They are the law and the constitution, and they found the balance at the start, each agreeing to the other, each agreeing to respect the other. And on the foundation, the Yolngu world is built. And around them, and around us, the law of the land remains. My identity is the sacred saltwater crocodile. And I am a Maralicha man. But there are things that run in my blood, give me the authority. This is my identity and my strength. Everything to me, and it links me to my land and my future. Each Yolngu has an identity that is drawn from our ancestors. You saw the Goak, the travels of the Goak this morning at the opening. My cousin Graham, he is a Magalili. He is also Urpan, the emu, which is also on a coat of arms of Australia. He is Ngoikal, the kingfish. And he is Goak, the night bird. Goak is an ancestor who links Yolngu together. And now it's a pathway to the Milky Way. The kingfish marked the pathway for Goak, striking the coast and creating Yilan to mark his way. Goak rests here at Gulkula before its journey starts or continues, linking clans together. With him, he carries the sacred raki, or the rope, the fur of the possum, the ropo, or the marango, and it bounds together to mark the rope. And the fur is given willingly by that ancestor, Rupu. The string is called Burkun, and it is an item of our Yolngu constitution. Today, Graham brought that Burkun as a symbol of unity. Not just for our people, but for all Australians. Through him, the marango gives it to you as well. And you will feel the wind here at Gulkula. It also has sacred meaning to us. When it rises as a mist, it is garden. Owa Kolongol. And with it comes the Watu, the dog. Moving through the mist, shaking the wetness off its back, coming in to be with us. And when we see the mist, we think of Gar, the spider ancestor, who makes the web each night only for it to be destroyed during the day, only for it to be remade again. And on the Longurma wind, from the north came the Macassan seafarers, our trading partners, who joined with us for hundreds of years in peaceful coexistence. Look to the east, and you see the Gulf of Carpentaria. To us, these are the waters, Amanbunga, the deep currents upon which the Wimiri, the great whale, travels. And we sing its movements as it links us to the northeast and on to Cape Wessel or Merchant Bar. And then to the northeast of Cape York, and further to the islands of Bado and beyond. And his breath is the clouds and the rain that gives us life and which gives you life too. And when the thunder sounds as the wet season begins, we hear the power of the birimbira. O Wodango, the lightning snakes who travels down from the fresh waters on top of Dalawi Bay, shedding its skin as it moves powerfully into the salt waters, calling the lightning and the rains that signal a time of renewal. And from that renewal comes goodness. For the Gumaj people, it was here at Gulkula that sacred laws were made and our world was put in order, and the land that we share with all Australians was made right. I am talking about the rights of birth, death, creation and belonging. Yerika and Dua, Yoto and Yindi. This is our law. This is what marks out this country as special, and which link all Australian people together. This is our holy trinity. Wanga, the land. Kapo, the rivers and the sea. Kanyo, the stars. And this is your holy trinity too. And these laws that govern us are not unique to Yolngu. The whole of the continent is linked by the song lines. And ancient powers that lie around us and within us. Kuri, Mari, Gabi, Nunga, Palawa, Wemu Anango, Larakia Yolngu. We are all in this together. And all Australians are part of us. Territorians, Victorians, South Australians, New South Welshmen, Queenslanders, Western Australians, Tasmanians, Canberrans, you are all part of our reality. We welcome you here. We listen to you. And we bring you into our ceremony and the life of a people. We don't expect you to know all and every detail. We don't expect you to know even one word from our song cycles or how to paint the dolang or the designs, or to master a guckle, which is a movement of our ancestors when we dance. We don't expect you to be there every moment during our rituals. Or as we care for the country, or use the country, but we include you as fellow Australians. You are in our constitution already. You are here, and we don't deny the reality of who you are and the life that you have lived in modern Australia. If we denied you, we would be denying the world around us. We have hope for the future, and I believe in a world that is better than the past. We love this country. It is Australia to us. We want it to be strong and powerful from north to south, to east to west. And we want to be in it. We don't want to be sitting on the side waiting for Garma each year. We want each day to be a day when we are fully engaged in the life of a nation through the rule book that runs Australia, the Australian Constitution. We stay strong with our laws and our constitutions. But our laws do not run the country. The Australian Constitution runs the country. And it governs the Parliament and the courts and the taxes that we pay. And the allies we make and the enemies we fight. Yet, Australia is not complete. Ladies and gentlemen, Australia is built on an ancient foundation. Let the voice of our people be in the Constitution. Let it be given shape by our Parliament. Let us then have the conversations that make things right for the children that will inherit the nation from us. The great Marbury decision united us in the common law. Now let's unite in the Constitution through the will of the Australian people. This is the opportunity we have to vote when we vote, because it is not just Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people that will be given voice when the referendum wins. It will be the land and sea, the stars and our ancestors. It will be Australia. It will be all of us. Most of all, it will be for our children and their children. This is the gift my brother sought to give Australia. That is why he kept the sacred strong, sacred lines and sacred manikai so strong, so that he could share it with you, with all Australia, and through Australia, the world. So on behalf of my family, I say that it is time for the nation to believe that we can be complete. It is time to trust ourselves as a nation, to trust our parliament, to trust our democracy, and to trust each other. Myself, I believe in this pathway. A pathway to unity. I believe in this ancient southern land. I believe in Australians, and I believe in Australia. Like you, I have children. I have grandchildren. I want a better future for them, where they can thrive and be the best that they can be. I want the same future for your children and your grandchildren. I want our children and our grandchildren to be interlinked, connected as people. But the sacred burkun that was carried out this morning. And I want them to know the power of the lightning snake and be connected by the Garchambal and the soul of the crocodile and to travel to the stars with the Goa. Ladies and gentlemen, I will be voting yes. I will be voting for my children's future and your children's future, connected together in this ancient land. Under the southern stars, walking side by side, living side by side. Thank you.
Thank you, Jawa, for your incredible, inspirational speech, and we can all learn from your wisdom. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, can you please all join me in welcoming the Prime Minister of Australia to the stage for the Garma address.
Well, I must say that's quite an act to follow, Jawa. I feel like saying what he said. Can I acknowledge the people of the Yolngu Nation? I recognise all their elders, leaders and families who have given so much to Australia. In particular, I acknowledge the Gumash clan, whose lands we are meeting on today. I also acknowledge my parliamentary colleagues from across the political spectrum. I acknowledge union and business leaders, faith and sporting leaders, and all of my fellow Australians here today, Indigenous and non-Indigenous, coming together. Namari Bookmark. That didn't respond. Good. I got nothing. We'll try it again. Namari Bookmark. That's better. Thank you very much. In May this year, I had the extraordinary honour of paying tribute to the life and legacy of a truly great Australian. A man it is hard to imagine Garma without. Even as I look out on this crowd, I somehow expect to see him looking back. Yunupingu walked in two worlds, with authority, power, and grace. And he sought always to make those two worlds whole. His very name meant the place on the horizon where the sea merges with the sky. How fitting that he devoted his life to seeking change in a spirit of unity, momentous national change, but also practical local change. That was his vision for the community he helped to build, the opportunities he worked to create, the lives and country he sought to change for the better. Not a conflict between two identities, not a clash of two cultures, but an embrace of both for the betterment of both. Like here at Garma, the salt water meeting the fresh and flowing on together. Friends, this is the very same aspiration. The Uluru Statement from the Heart holds for every Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander child. As it says so memorably, when we have power over our destiny, our children will flourish. They will walk in two worlds and their culture will be a gift to their country. Think about those words, a gift to their country. Even in expressing the most fundamental and elemental hope every parent has for their child, the chance to flourish, the opportunity for a better life. Even in that moment, there is still that spirit of generosity to others, the offer of a gift to us all. The understanding that both our worlds have so much to gain from listening to each other, learning from one another, working together. And the genius of the Uluru Statement from the Heart and all the elders and leaders and Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people who poured their hopes and aspirations and effort and goodwill into it is that it doesn't just articulate the noble goal of a better future. It offers Australia the practical means and the path to achieve it. My government supports the Uluru Statement from the Heart and its call for an Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander voice in our constitution, which is what the coming referendum is about. A vehicle for real and practical progress. A committee of Indigenous Australians, chosen by Indigenous Australians, to work for Indigenous Australians in every part of our nation. the regions and remote communities, big cities and the Torres Strait Islands, giving Parliament and government the advice to drive better results in health, education, employment and housing. That's what The Voice is about. Advice. Advice that will ensure government benefits from the perspective and experience of the people on the ground. So we listen to communities, make better decisions and achieve better results. Here at Garma, you don't need to imagine what that would look like. You can see it all around you. You can share in the vision for Australia that those elders and leaders endorsed at Uluru at the First Nations Constitutional Convention way back in 2017. Walking around this festival, you can see for yourself how much can be achieved when Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people are heard and empowered. The fantastic local schools were working side by side with their communities to boost attendance and achieve great results. Indigenous rangers managing land and sea country as they have for thousands of generations. Employers instilling the new pride and confidence that comes from having a good job. Training programs and job pathways ensuring young people gain a greater sense of belonging and self-belief. Medical services helping children grow up healthy and safe, making sure communities can get the treatment and services they need on country. Or the Dilak Council, who I had the privilege of meeting with yesterday, bringing together representatives from the 13 clans of North East Arnhem Land, connecting culture and local knowledge to government decision-making, taking responsibility for a better future. Many of these programs and initiatives have been built up through decades of hard work and goodwill. Often they've been run on a shoestring, providing generations with the basis of a better life. And more than that, giving people the skills and capacity and opportunity to thrive, to flourish. That's what can be achieved by listening to locals. And something else happens when governments listen. Investment is effective. This is an economically rationalist argument as well, because the funding actually gets to the people and the communities who need it. The money is invested in things that work, creating jobs and building secure homes and backing local schools and keeping people healthy. And friends, here at Garma, we can also see the coming together of how it enlarges the world and enriches both. We see Australians of all ages and backgrounds, all faiths and traditions, all walks of life, all sides of politics, sharing in the welcoming beauty and joy of this place. Children from Melbourne and Adelaide and Perth kicking the footy in the red dirt with Gumaj boys and girls. Australians of all ages, from every part of the country, from all walks of life, lining up to share a meal and talk about what they've seen and learned and enjoyed that very day. Artists and students from all over Australia, witnessing the majesty of song and dance and painting that speaks for 65,000 years of love of the land and waters. All of us here thinking how lucky we are as Australians to be part of this continuing story. The great treasure we gain from embracing the fullness of our history, a heritage and tradition unique in all the nations of the world. At this year's referendum, we have the opportunity to recognise and celebrate this culture and connection in our constitution. And through A Voice, we can ensure that the Garma spirit of learning and cooperation and shared progress is not confined to this one part of Australia and one group of Australians for 4 days a year. It is shared with our nation to serve our whole nation, to ensure that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people everywhere have the opportunity of a better life. So instead of the inspiring success stories we see around us being shining exceptions like stars in the night sky, there can indeed be a new day. An Australia where more Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander children are going to school, finishing school, and finding a path to a qualification they want and deserve for a job they love. Where more families know the stability of a roof over their head. Where communities are safer, happier, and healthier. Shaped and secured by the voices and expertise and passion and vision of the people who call them home. This is what voting yes represents. A once-in-a-generation opportunity for real, overdue, and much-needed change. And that is why today I can promise all of you and all Australians, there will be no delaying or deferring of this referendum. We will not deny the urgency of this moment. We will not kick the can down the road. We will not abandon substance for symbolism or retreat to platitudes at the expense of progress. My friend Jawa spoke about the kangaroo and spoke about it being one of the part of the Australian crest. And as I was sitting there listening to his powerful call to action and call for support on behalf of all of us, I was reminded that the kangaroo and the emu that sit on the crest, that sit on my letterhead, are two of the only animals in the world that never go backwards. They just go forwards. And the referendum is about whether we retreat into ourselves or have the courage to advance forward. That is what it is about. Prime ministers and governments have come and gone, but Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people have been so clear. The form of constitutional recognition they are asking for is a voice, not our sympathy, not a symbol, but a vehicle for progress, a practical tool to make their children's lives better. Not just something that will feel good, something that will do good, that will make a positive difference. We can get this done together, and we can get this done now this year. Because if not us, who? And if not now, when? In the months ahead, just as we will continue to make it clear what voting yes will achieve, Australians should be equally clear about what voting no means. It is more of the same. Not only rejecting the opportunity to do better, but accepting that what we have is somehow good enough. An 8-year gap in life expectancy in the land of the fair go. A suicide rate twice as high in the lucky country. Shocking rates of disease in a nation with some of the world's best healthcare. Only 4 out of 19 closing the gap targets on track. Surely no leader can honestly say that is good enough. Surely no leader can say it ain't broke, don't fix it. Surely no leader can imagine that change is not desperately and urgently needed. And that's why, with every passing day, it becomes more and more obvious that the No campaign are desperate to talk about anything but the actual question that is before the Australian people, because they understand that more of the same is not just unacceptable, it is indefensible. And this is where the Uluru Statement from the Heart is also such a clear and practical appeal to the head, to the compassion we feel in our hearts, but also the truth that we know in our heads. Because the principle of the voice is grounded in irresistible logic, in the unavoidable fact that if we continue to do the same things in the same way, we will get the same outcomes. It's a message reinforced by the Productivity Commission only last month, warning that if we continue to assume that government knows best, then things will only get worse. Of course, to all of you, and indeed to a great many Australians, none of this is news. Over the years, people have heard these facts, seen images of hardship, read stories of disadvantage, and perhaps, from time to time, they've imagined what it would be like to walk in someone else's shoes. Imagine what it would be like for their daughter to be at greater risk in childbirth, their son to be more likely to go to jail than to go to university, their community twice as likely to be shattered by suicide, their friends and relatives more likely to be afflicted by diseases virtually eliminated elsewhere, as Noel Pearson articulated in his fine speech to this gathering just an hour ago. Naturally, in imagining all of this, Australians will have asked themselves, but what can I do about it? Intergenerational disadvantage, what can I do about it? What difference can I make? Well, this year, there is a simple answer. Yes. We can vote yes. And I'll give you a bit of a practice run here. What way are you going to vote?
Yes!
Friends, just as importantly, we can convince our fellow Australians to vote yes as well, because that's what will decide this referendum. Everyone having one vote. Those who've thought deeply about it, and those who haven't yet looked at what the referendum wording is going forward. We know that most Australians have never got out their constitution as bedside reading. And that's why the campaign is there to be won. Because what will decide this referendum is those conversations, the respectful, genuine discussions Australians have with one another, engaging and explaining as neighbours and colleagues and friends, as teammates in community sporting clubs of every code, because every code has embraced this cause, as fellow worshippers in every faith, because leaders of all faiths have backed this change, as supporters of every political party, because representatives from right across the political spectrum are campaigning for yes and are here with us today. As employers and business leaders who understand the value and power of a yes vote. As members of communities drawn from every corner of the world, because those who have added to the fabric of our great multicultural society know how much it means to have your traditions respected and your contribution recognised. As trade unionists in every workplace, recognising that no one should be left behind. At the heart of it all is a conversation between generations. Young Australians talking to their parents and their grandparents about what this moment represents for their generation and for the generations to come. Explaining just what voting yes can mean for our country and our future. Making it clear that there is nothing to fear, but so much to gain. And making it plain that there is indeed no time to waste. Now, in any democracy, we know that there is no such thing as a foregone conclusion. There are no guarantees of success, but that's not a reason to delay. It's why we have to hold to the courage of our convictions. At this very venue 1 year ago, when I confirmed that my government would fulfil our election commitment to hold a referendum for constitutional recognition this year, Yunupingu asked me, just over there, I will never forget it, someone who'd shown such remarkable leadership, but the truth is had been let down from time to time, but who'd shown his resilience. He said to me, are you serious? And I said to him, yes, we're going to do it. And in our last conversation, on the very day that I stood alongside the referendum working group earlier this year to announce a very clear proposition that every Australian will be voting on, he told me, you spoke truth. Australians now have a chance to deliver this change, to take up the gracious request of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples to advance reconciliation, to take up the offer of the Uluru Statement from the Heart, a message extended from all points of the southern sky. I read from it. We invite you to walk with us in a movement of the Australian people for a better future. Well, I say over coming months, don't just walk, jog, run, because we do need to get there. Because that invitation was an invitation to all of us, and all of us have a part to play. All of us can make a difference. All of us can get this done. One final point I want to make about what's ahead. There are some in the no camp, including the leader of the Federal Liberal Party, who say they support constitutional recognition, but only a legislative voice. I say this, not only does this mean rejecting the form of recognition that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people have requested, a form of recognition designed through more than a decade-long process of consultation, the majority of which occurred under the coalition government, their commitment to legislative voice also undermines every other argument that they make against it. Clearly, they acknowledge that a voice is needed, otherwise why legislate it? Clearly, they recognise it will make a positive difference, otherwise why legislate it? Clearly, they don't see it as divisive or radical or any of the other noise and confusion they are seeking to inject into this referendum. Otherwise, why legislate it? The only difference that all of this confected outrage is about is whether it be enshrined in the Constitution or whether, after all of this struggle going back to 1788, it can be dismissed with the stroke of a pen by a future government. That is what this referendum is about. This referendum is about recognition, but it's also about listening in order to achieve better results. That's all. That's all. And over coming weeks, there'll be attempts to talk about a whole range of things. There's a new one every day. Questions designed to raise more questions, but to avoid the fundamental question, which is how can anyone who analyses this not say, let's give this a go. Let's get this done going forward. And the reason why Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people are seeking this form of recognition, in Yunupingu's words, through serious constitutional reform, is just that, to ensure the substance of the recognition. So it will have the stability to plan for the long term, for the generational challenges we are facing, but also the generational progress that we can make for lasting unity. Friends, more than 17 million Australians of our fellow Australians are enrolled to vote in this referendum. The highest number of voters in our nation's history. This includes, by the way, a record number of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander voters. In this decisive moment, each of us holds an equal responsibility, and each of us has an equal opportunity. Yes, we can make history together. More importantly, we can shape the future together. We can vote yes in a spirit of unity. We can vote yes with optimism and hope, not just for success at this referendum, but our greater success as a nation. We can bring our country together. We can bring our two worlds together, with our hearts and, yes, with our heads. This year, on Referendum Day, the power to reach for a better Australia is in our hands. Let's seize it together. Let's vote yes for recognition. Let's vote yes for a voice. And let's vote yes for the better future that both will deliver for all of us. Thanks very much.
And that was the Prime Minister Anthony Albanese addressing the forum here at Garma 2023. A lot of love in the auditorium for the Prime Minister. Well, that concludes the morning session here at Garma. Mob here will now go and take a lunch break. Obviously, the events here got underway a little behind time, so everyone pretty hungry after a big morning of forums. But before we leave you, we're going to revisit some of the last night's beautiful Boongal and opening ceremony. Obviously, the key forums are a big part of the day here, but really the heart of Garma is that ceremony and Boongal. So let's enjoy some of last night's Boongal.
Yo, ngaraya ko jaka boromunyarun. To ngara garmango. Kololo bookmark for the Boongal. My name is Chakabura Munyarun, and I'm here at the Garma for Boongal to welcome everybody. Manmak.